past. So I'm super excited. First, you might notice there's a slight gender imbalance on the panel, intentional by design. That brings a lot of averages back together, and welcome, everybody. And again, my name is Ida Rademacher. I lead the financial security program, and it really is my pleasure to be here with all of you. And I'm not going to do a lot of preamble to this conversation, and ideally, it's a pretty animated end-of-day conversation, and I think we get some of the best topic material leading into the final keynote of the day. The topic really was the path forward to rebuilding economic security, retirement economic security as a subset of this broader piece. But I loved what the question that was raised in the panel right before lunch, I think is absolutely the right setup for this. And somebody stood up, and it was an incredibly good, rich conversation around tax reform and the lessons from almost 30 years ago. I mean, really, it's a long time coming, that conversation. But the gentleman stood up and he said, when are we really going to have a retirement security conversation in this country that is not a subset of a different conversation, that is not a subset of a tax revenue conversation or something else? When are we going to have that conversation? And we see that it's being clamored for by the American public. And so that's the question. And the part is, if we did get to have that conversation, would we be ready? Who would be in it? And what would be the ideas on the table? And so that's what this conversation is really about, I think, today, is there's some incredibly thoughtful ideas represented in the room, and especially on this panel, about if you're actually going to take it from the top, if you're going to think about it as an inclusive savings system in this country, what would be the components? What would be needed? What are the pros and cons of that idea? And I think one of the things that Fiona and I will do with this is, you know, throw some, I wouldn't say really bad wrenches in the wheels of this, but even as we think we've got a whole system doing, we're looking ahead and we're like, oh, the 1099s and contingent work and portability and longevity, and there's going to be other things that we haven't solved for even in these great plans. But that's where we want to go with the conversation. That's where we want to go with the questions. So we invite you to be thinking ahead as we begin this conversation. Let me start with you, Melissa, and I know you have some slides, but State Street's put a lot of thought into what's the ecosystem, what's a comprehensive approach to retirement security. So with a private sector slant to that. So can you walk us through your thinking?
First, I want to thank you, Ida, and I want to thank Diane and the NERS team for inviting me here today. The conference has been fantastic so far, and I'm going to pick up on a lot of the themes that have already been discussed earlier in the day. There's been a lot of doom and gloom. So to set the context, I'm just going to add one more statistic to that, which is that according to...
We call this the American Carnage slide.
Is that it? No. According to EBRI, the retirement savings gap stands at over $4 trillion. So there's a lot of elements to that. You've heard some of them today. People aren't saving enough even when they're in a plan. And as Diane so eloquently said earlier today, even when people are in a plan, when they get to sort of that end point, how do they manage that money in retirement? So we really do need to pay a lot of attention to this issue of lifetime income. We at State Street are very passionate about that issue. I could talk for hours about it, but I'm not. But at State Street, we started thinking about, you don't get to any of those issues of adequate savings and lifetime income and leakage from the system if you don't have access to a plan. And I think that's what we've been talking a lot about today. So there are a lot of people, we can debate the numbers, you know, is it 50% of the workforce or whatever. But the fact of the matter is that a lot of people don't have access. And we at State Street applaud the states for stepping up to this issue where there's been a void at the federal level. We think that they are tackling an enormous issue. I loved what John Shiner said earlier today. You know, they're so interrelated with so many other kinds of issues that we don't even think about the impact of not having enough savings for retirement. So even though we applaud what the states are doing, we do think that there are some issues around the state solutions. Number one is every state is doing it a little bit differently. So there's not that uniformity among all the states, and I think that that will create more and more problems as we go along and more states adopt different solutions. Number two is it is, for those who are in the Secure Choice program, it's an IRA-based solution, and as you heard earlier, that limits the amount of money that people can put into retirement savings, and it also doesn't allow for employer contributions. It doesn't have the ERISA fiduciary protections around it. So at State Street, we started to think more globally, literally, about this issue. And so what we did is we looked at systems around the world, what was working, what wasn't. And we were particularly intrigued by what's going on in the UK. And for those of you who haven't been following that, back in 2012, they put a program into place where they actually are requiring all employers, down to the smallest of employers where you may only employ a nanny, and you will have to set up a retirement plan and automatically enroll your employees into a plan. They're phasing it in over time so that by 2019, all employers will be subject to this program. In addition, it also requires not only employee contributions, but employer contributions that will ratchet up over time. So at State Street, we started talking about what could possibly work here in the US. And we decided that having some sort of uniform federal type program would really make a lot of sense and really take the best elements of the 401k system today and build on those. So we came up with this program, and it's got four elements to it. So the first element, and the most controversial, and I'm sure Aliyah is going to address this, is that we, like in the UK and like the states are doing in Secure Choice, we would require that all employers auto-enroll their employees into a defined contribution plan. And we would take the best elements of 401k plans, auto-enroll, auto-escalate, start them out at 6%. And you saw from John Scott's slides that there wasn't a huge differential in terms of whether you auto-enroll somebody at 3% or 6%. It's minuscule in terms of people noticing. The inertia works really in your favor. And we, like in 401k plans, we would default them into default investments, target date funds, life cycle funds, managed accounts, because most people don't know how to manage their own money effectively. So we're concerned about the impact on small employers, as Aliyah is. And so we want to make this almost costless for small employers. So the plan, there's a lot of specifics. But some of the things that I think very much targeted towards small employers are we would exempt new employers from this requirement. So anybody who hasn't been in business for at least 3 years would not be subject to this program. In addition, there would be tax credits for at least 5 years to cover the administrative costs of the program. And this has been in a lot of bipartisan legislation over time. So we know that this is something that's supported by Republicans and Democrats. In addition, we would not require, as the UK does, employer contributions into these plans. But for any small employer that makes a contribution into these plans, they would get a tax credit for that. And the last element of this, again, with recognition that this is going to be a burden on smaller employers, is another bipartisan proposal that's been in a lot of legislation, which is open MEPs, so that small employers can band together and have administrative cost and administrative efficiencies and effectiveness. So those are the four elements of the program. We asked EBRI to do some analysis of this proposal versus some of the auto IRA proposals that have been out there, both at the federal and the state level. So what EBRI found is that under auto IRA proposals, even in the best case scenario, when you're auto enrolling somebody at 6% with a 0% opt-out rate, the most you can close that $4 trillion savings gap is about 12%, okay? So our plan, by contrast, with no opt-outs, which we know is unrealistic, but even at a 25% opt-out rate, it would close the gap by more than 13%, closer to 14%. And the one thing I would note, now granted we're not the UK, but the UK has found tremendous success both in raising their coverage rates over time, but also with the amount of opt-outs. They were predicting 10% opt-out rates in their program. They've been well under 10%. They've been at 7%. They also re-enroll people after 3 years, and the opt-out rates after 3 years are only 1% to 2%. And this holds true even across ages. Of course, the biggest impact is for younger employees, because those closer to retirement obviously have a greater burden to fill. You're going to hear from Jim Lockhart in a little bit. I would say my former CEO, Rob Henriksen, was on the commission that developed that bipartisan proposal, and you'll hear similar themes from Jim, I hope. So I think that this is something that can get bipartisan support. It's a difficult political time, I realize, but we are talking to both Democrats and Republicans, and I know we can talk about that some more. So I'm going to turn it over to Teresa.
That sounds great. So I'm going to ask you to pivot off of that. I know that you're, and I think, raise up some of the ideas. Many in the room might know them, but I think that, you know, in terms of just what does the debate and the discussion universe look like in the next few years as we think about this? You bring a whole different dimension to that work with your research,
well,
Teresa.
Thank you. And so my perspective is actually as an academic. But I do have a book with Tony James, who is the president of Blackstone. So it's a strange pairing, lefty academic and a capitalist. So we come together as a practitioners. But let me frame this. And we've embroidered the plan, the same with State Street. So it's a lot of sequence and embroidered. But we haven't put enough of a spotlight on the problem. And this is, I think, Representative Crowley talked about that I spoke to the House Democrats and I only talked about the problem. I think we really have missed that chance in the last 15 years. This is it. The election did not change the retirement math, and mainly it's because of the baby boomers. It's 73 million people over 25 years will be in 65 to 70. So that's it's a huge, the generation behind them is small, the generation behind them is larger. This actually means that the chances that you will know, be related to, or be a poor or near poor adult will go up by 71%. That's just calculated by the percentage share of the population that will be a poor or near poor adult in the next in next year. So forget all those graphs that we've seen forever and we're really bored by, you know, median 401k account balances, lack of coverage, DB's down, DC's up. I'm going to stop framing the crisis in that way. It's really important to shed the spotlight in these other areas, which is the increasing chance that you will meet or be related to a poor and near poor elderly. That's almost unprecedented in the post-war period. The other way to think of the problem, besides deprivation, is actually downward mobility. Again, a political issue that we've seen some part happening in the Rust Belt, which means since Social Security and the DB system had grown, the chances that a middle-class worker would be a poor or near poor adult fell dramatically. But it's increasing. So the chances that a middle class near retiree will be a poor or near poor adult, those chances are increasing. That's downward mobility. The third problem is actually the risk of austerity given these problems. It's going the fact that you'll have more elders who are poor in your community means a hit on state and local budgets. They fund Medicaid. They fund housing. They fund emergency services. The fastest growing group in New York in housing, in emergency housing, are people over 55. It also means, since I'm an economist, some real predictive effects on the macro economy. So as we think that it's really good if we could actually absorb some slow growth productivity, you know, by bringing older people into the labor market, so that we get some boost from increased labor force participation among 64 to 74-year-olds, you have to actually model the next step. What will that do to average productivity? Because you get much more growth with productivity than you do with increased labor force participation. If we didn't, we would just put kids to work. We have to care about productivity. Increasing the labor force participation of older workers will lower national productivity. And it may have an impact on the wage growth for younger workers, precisely because of the numbers. So that's the problem. What are our solutions? It's very similar, but very different from the State Street solution and from the state IRA solutions. So Tony James and I have boldly stepped up and say, based on looking at the regularities in the academic research, which kind of pension design actually works for this criteria. You can write this down, the four parts. Efficiency, effectiveness, helps the productive base of the macroeconomy. I care a lot about employers, this working for the producers. And third, it has to be simple and legitimate, which is a lot of the opt-out IRA has a lot of that. Ours isn't simple, and that's its flaw. Efficiency, it's much more efficient to make people save, no opt-out. So just like Social Security, it's a mandatory program. All workers in our plan have to contribute at least 1.5% with the option to buy more. The employer, 1.5%, and an important partner in accumulation is the government. We have a refundable tax credit. It's a key part of this plan. The second piece is very different from other plans, even though it's reflective of the Bipartisan Policy Commission, is that the efficient way to save for retirement once you've got people to accumulate is a pooled investment plan. So we actually have professionals manage a DB-type structure. No life cycle funds, no just hyper-liquid accounts. It's a pooled investment with no surprise in private equity. My writing partner is a president of a private equity firm. But I'm a trustee of $53 billion, and we have private equity. We have a diverse portfolio. And the third thing is a deaccumulation. It's mostly annuitized. There's a lot of embroidery around the plan, but I feel it's much more important to actually link the design to our goals. Our plan is better than the IRA, a MEP plan, because it's efficient. It's a way to actually get people in the plan to stay forever because you don't have the opt-out. It's effective because the risk-adjusted rate of return is higher, and in a slow growth, you need it. It is actually, when you model it, it's more macro stable. It looks like the Vermont MEP plan, where Vermont is one of the only states that have a plan that isn't an auto IRA. It looks like the Bipartisan Commission plan with being a multiple employer plan. And so I think it meets all the criteria of a well-designed plan.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. So both of you started by framing a problem in a specific way, put out some design tenets. Aliya, you start from a different place. You start from a specific understanding of the pain points of employers. And so I would love not just reaction to what's here already, but your own sense of what does the chamber move with? What does it prioritize? And how would you put it into this mix?
Sure. So when I came in this morning, I was priding myself on being around people who have very different opinions from the chamber. And after sitting here today, I realized I haven't been doing that good of a job. So thank you, Diane, for making me get a little bit better about that. But to your point, Ida, you're right. We have a different perspective. I'm coming at it from the employer perspective. And the good thing about being here and hearing different viewpoints, and I think Diane said this earlier, is that generally retirement issues have been bipartisan, and I think that's because we have the same goal. We all want retirement security. We want to see people have a secure retirement, even the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. So the differences have been how we get there. And in some ways, it's also perspective, because from the chamber, it really is an employer perspective. And we don't see the employers as solving the retirement crisis or the retirement crisis. We see employers as a piece of that. And so within that perspective, when we look at the employer role, it is very different and very limited from that. And so about 2 weeks ago, we put out a paper. I have a little handout here talking point. A paper, Securing Retirement Legislative Roadmap. And this is really second addition to what we did a few years ago. And so we've taken looks at this really substantially in the last 6 or 7 years. And with these two papers, we start at it, we come in and we say, okay, we want big ideas, bold ideas. And to be quite honest, we come back to kind of what people consider ideas that are on the fringes, the things we've seen before and some of the things we've heard here. And it's really because of a couple of different reasons. One, employers feel like they have been successful in their part of the system. Those employers that have chosen to implement retirement plans have been successful in that and don't want to see that system go away. Two, big ideas do cause change and upset and turmoil, and we are concerned that in that there might be more disruption to the system than help, especially in the near term, even for, if there's help further out. So that's kind of where we're working from. I initially planned to go through the roadmap, but I kind of think I might leave that to y'all and hit some of the bigger points that we're talking here. The chamber does not support a mandate in any form. We've never supported a mandate for employers, and in this political environment, we definitely won't support a mandate for employers. But I would give two arguments for that in the retirement space. One, we already have a mandatory retirement program, and it's Social Security. And I think what's missing a lot of time from this conversation is coverage versus adequacy. And so we have a lot of people talking about Social Security not being an adequate program, and it's already mandated, and yet we want to add another mandated program on top of that. So I feel our focus needs to change a little bit if we're talking about adequacy. And in saying that, I think the chamber is a little bit at fault for that too, because even when we talk about this, we separate employer-provided retirement from Social Security. And there probably very quickly needs to be a conversation that includes both of those. And to the point, just with Nest in England, I think part of the reason they've been so successful is that's what they did. Their solution doesn't just look at the private options, it also looked at their federal or state program. Two, the second argument is that I think it's an apples and oranges comparison when we look at the success of the private employer system and what a mandate would do if you translate that. In the private system, it's a benefit that employers have chosen to provide as a retention tool, as an attraction tool. And so they are vested in making sure that the program runs well, that it's robust, that it has benefits that people are interested in. When you put a mandate on employers, you don't have that same kind of energy behind it. And so I'm not sure that some of these outcomes we're expecting will be exactly the same. And with that, not just will the employers be different, but the population we're dealing with will be very different. We're not looking at, and I think this was mentioned earlier, people who might not be able to save in the same way or have the same ability. So it makes me a little nervous when we try to apply what we've seen in the private employer voluntary system to a mandated system and think it's going to work out the same. Mm-hmm. Having said that, I think where we have a commonality, the chamber does support the open MEP system and would like to see employers be able to pool their resources. We've supported that for a while. It's a bipartisan proposal that for some reason has not gained any traction, but hopefully will soon. We have a lot of concern about the multi-employer pension system, which someone raised earlier today. Unfortunately, we don't have a bang-up solution for that. I think it takes a lot of conversation. I think it takes a lot of honest conversation, a lot of people in the room. And it's going to take a lot of pain, but it's a decision about pain now versus really devastation later. So waiting for that. And then, tax reform and how that's going to impact the retirement system. And back to Ida's original point, I think as a chamber, we would have lots of ideas if we were talking about, changes to the tax code in retirement reform. But instead, we're talking about changes to retirement and tax reform. And it's a very different, again, perspective to be in, and it puts you in a very different situation. So even though we might like to be playing offense there, I feel like we're going to be playing defense. And our ability to have these larger conversations might be overshadowed by this fear of tax reform and what might happen there.
Yeah, I think that's a muscle we have to keep exercising even as the current reality dictates the terms of the debate and maybe narrower frame. But really important points that you bring up. And I'm glad actually that Jim is following, because I know that the BPC really did realize that you couldn't look at just pillar one or pillar two. You had to look at what is the overall financial security snapshot of families as they go forward. Fiona, I want to invite you to actually come in to ask the next question or just provide the next observation. These are different variations on holistic solutions, but at their heart, they're about what are the ways of the future that we are comfortable with or feel compelled to pool the risks that are facing American families as they near retirement, the financial risks. I think that social policy of the 20th century pooled a lot of the risk of income, right? We had unemployment insurance, we had a lot of things, but this is a different thing. This is about pooling the risk of inadequacy in retirement and thinking about that. But also, I would counter that with Aliya, the idea that that's a choice that employers make. This is a private system. So your data and these kind of models, is there anything that you want to throw into the mix?
Yeah, I have a comment and a question. So I guess, I mean, I don't have a lot to say about coverage, but I think the question of adequacy is something that we've thought a lot about in our data. And, when I think about the massive amounts of data that, the Institute is working with and on which the firm sits, and then I pair that with sort of robo-investing, and this idea of moving the needle on automation and defaults into a much more customized, individually tailored machine where, you know, whether it's my paycheck is calibrated so that I'm not also having to make that, you know, 6% contribution in a pay period when my hours are down. And can we think about sort of smart paychecks mm-hmm. that are offsetting these, mm-hmm. you know, this volatility so that you're making those allocations in the months when your paycheck mm-hmm. is high and not when your paycheck is low. So there's, you know, sort of a little bit of, you know, machining that we can do with the paycheck. Then of course there is, you know, machining that we can do with the allocations and you know, whether they're coming out of your checking account or they're coming out of your paycheck, you know, so where you've got that same machine examining your income and your expenses and say, like, oh gosh, income spike, expense dip, this month we're flush. Money over here, you know. Can we, you know, we have these big data platforms, we have these algorithms that can be doing this math for people, for them. You know, and I guess so that was just a comment. But.
So Fiona, to your point, I mean, I think part of it is generational also. Yeah. I think that millennials are much more comfortable on the one hand using technology, and robo-advice is going to be part of that solution. It's interesting, we just did a study where we found that shockingly millennials, even though they want the app and the chat, okay, that was the bottom line. Right. They like the technology and they like to use it, but they also want that human interaction. Mm-hmm. So I think robo and any kind of tech solution is going to be part of it. But I think it goes sort of beyond that. I think that we do need to look at automation generally. I think I heard somebody from AEI years ago say that human beings, we are not economically rational beings, and we will not necessarily do what's in our economic best interest. And that's why automatic enrollment, auto escalation, and why our proposal starts at 6%, mm-hmm. ratchets up to 12, which we don't even think is enough. You have to do that for people because otherwise they won't mm-hmm. do it for themselves. Mm-hmm. They, you know, today we're very consumerism oriented. Mm-hmm. So I think. Mm-hmm. You've raised good points, but we got to fix them.
Yeah, and you know, to me, this brings up the question, again, it brings in both the public system and the private system, but mm-hmm. on the one hand, Aliya, we're talking about private choice of employees and employers. On the other hand, we're talking about 71% of people being in a financially precarious state in old age, which has implications for the economy, for those same small businesses about who can buy services, but so I'm just wondering if do we need to be looking from both sides of things? Is that something that the chamber does some research on? You know, I'm just curious about where your thinking is on that as well.
Right. So we haven't done research specifically on that, but we've been thinking about that
yeah.
because it is a concern, and obviously we want people to be consumers. It's important.
Yeah, that's right.
And maintain consumerism. And again, I think it goes back to this piece. I think it is important, and I caveated this earlier, we also look at, you know, employer-provided retirement separately from Social Security, but we are opening up to that conversation because I don't think you can effectively have these conversations separately anymore. And even looking at the public system and how that works and private-public partnerships, we haven't supported the Secure Choice programs, but we have supported other state-based retirement plans. And definitely feel like there's room for everybody in this space to make it better and to make people more secure. Our concerns, obviously, are where the burdens fall or the unfair burdens fall.
Right. Teresa?
I really like this idea. Thank you. That we could work together. Just like Walmart, actually, they're not anymore, but they were in support of a higher minimum wage because they wanted their shoppers to have more income. I would think small business would want to have this bulge of the population to actually have more demand. I do a lot of work in Detroit. A third of the aggregate demand in that region comes from DB plans or UAW healthcare plans or their pensions and Social Security. So actually the steady income and sure income from those three sources for retirees actually bolster that part of the country and probably many other parts of the country, and small businesses appreciate it. But second, I feel like we could be transported in a spaceship back in time mm-hmm. before Social Security was passed, because many of my predictions about demobility, deprivation, increased pressure in communities because of this wave of elderly could have been talked about there. State experiments before Social Security was passed look almost eerily like we see now. 25 to 28 states before Social Security was passed in 1933 to 1934 had some kind of old age income security plan. Many of them were going to piggyback on their state systems to make sure that there was retirement security for everybody. There was the Townsend Plan, as we know, in California mm-hmm. that was demanding a UBI, a universal basic income from all elderly, and everybody else stepped back and said, whoa, we actually need a social insurance plan. The income volatility was very much part of a large agrarian population. Where income volatility, income smoothing was very important. So we actually had the wisdom of crowds developed what all countries who are successful developed. No country has been able, I've told this to Senator Warren mm-hmm. and to Sanders and to Podesta, you know, people on the other side, no, we can't build a retirement income security system on Social Security. The only way countries have been able to provide a secure retirement for their middle class and lower middle class workers is through a funded system, because much of your benefits are paid by the financial sector. It's a pro-growth, pro-business, pro-producerist proposal. And so I know we have the problem, and so we actually developed a plan where we had smart employer contributions. Workers always had to pay their Social Security, but employers could vary when they paid for the defined benefit contribution. So what we learned across countries, across time, is that you need to fund your system at a low rate. I'm all in favor of low tax rates and low contribution rates, but the base has to be broad. It means every single time you make money, 1099, W-2, you pay into your retirement plan. No ifs, ands, or buts, no opt-outs, no re-enrollments. So that's why I'm strongly in favor of building on top of Social Security Plus. No choice.
I am guessing that I know we're going to try to actually, you want us to cut a little early for this panel. So I'd love to, if you have questions, come on up to the speaking. I actually, to this question, before we go into those questions, Aliya, really quickly, in the work that you do with employers, and when you think about the ways that they come into the conversation, do you have any advice or suggestions as this conversation becomes bolder, as it becomes uncomfortable in terms of conversations about mandates, what are ways to invite the conversation, the dialogue, to stay open with employers who are feeling burdened?
That's a tough question. because all employers are different, and it depends where they are on the spectrum. And that's part of the, you know, I think the frustration that comes out in retirement security. We're not talking about all large employers that have huge margins and have time, energy, and resources to implement a retirement plan. And we're not talking about all startup companies that don't have any of that. There's a range in between. I did have one provider say, and I think this is probably the most accurate, he says it's a point in time conversation. You have a conversation with the owner of a business at that point that owner is thinking about retirement or thinking about benefits, or something has happened that triggers that thought in their mind. So that's it's not a very accurate answer, because no one knows when that point in time is.
And you can figure out how do you produce points in time.
Right, well.
As a national conversation needs to start, we'll go there. But yeah, what's your question, ma'am? Go ahead.
Thank you.
Introduce yourself.
I thought we could just look at this concept of conversations and burdens. For many of us in this room, you know, you haven't had a conversation with us. I've been retired for 16 years. And what is our perspective on what's going on? And I will say that my dry cleaners, this is right around the corner from me, there are 8 families on my side of the block who are retired. 6 of us are public employees. That dry cleaner wouldn't stay in business if we didn't bring our things there. And if we didn't have an adequate pension, we wouldn't be bringing our things there. So I think we're very integral to the success of small businesses as well as large. There's not a car on the block that's more than 5 years old. We are filling those cars with gasoline. We are buying insurance. We are doing all these things because we are adequately compensated in retirement. But the very dry cleaners that I'm going to is not involved in the retirement of his employees or even himself in an adequate and sustainable way. And I think that we all bear the burden to make sure that those people have an adequate retirement, because 10 years from now, those very members of the private sector are going to be unable to pay their bills, and the taxation is going to fall on us, who have been good savers and who have been participating in a retirement plan prior to that. I think that, you know, it's a two-way street. I will buy fine clothes, nice jewelry, get them cleaned as long as I have the money. And I will, but I don't feel it's my obligation to take my not private sector friends out to lunch. And that is what's going to be happening. I really want you to, you know, you need to talk to us, because we have had these experiences about who says yes and who says no to our social engagement, our shopping engagements, and our business engagements. And we, you know, some of us can actually afford to play golf and some of us can't. And I think all these things are really, you know, pie in the sky when you're just talking the numbers. But when you get down to the people, this is a huge, important issue. And if you want consumers, you have to give us the opportunity to all become consumers. Thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate your comment. And I think it goes to what we were saying in terms of it's a comprehensive pie. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think Lynn said it earlier, if you squeeze part of the balloon, another part pops. So I want you to be a consumer, but I also want that business there for you to buy from them. And it is a balancing act. And, you know, unfortunately, I am working and hope to work with others to find that right balancing act, but we haven't found it yet. And I'm not in a position to push employers to a point where they can't provide services, because then it doesn't matter if you have consumers or not, if they're not businesses there.